We have seen that the solutions of a system of linear differential equations are easy to interpret if all eigenvalues are real. Either positive, then the solution would grow in that direction, or negative, then they would decay in that direction, or zero, and then they would stay constant in that direction. The situation becomes more complicated if we have complex eigenvalues. And complex eigenvalues can actually occur even if you have a real matrix, at least if A is not symmetric. Since A is real, though, eigenvalues and eigenvectors always come in complex conjugate pairs, and that's relatively easy to see. So let's assume we have a solution to our eigenvalue equation. A is an eigenvector of matrix A and lambda the corresponding eigenvalue. Now, if A and lambda are complex, you can take the complex conjugate of the whole equation. But since matrix A is real, you can just drop this complex conjugate again and you arrive at this equation. And this shows if A and lambda are eigenvectors and eigenvalue of matrix A, then A complex conjugate and lambda complex conjugate are also eigenvalues and eigenvectors of matrix A because they fulfill the same equation. Now we have a real matrix, we have complex eigenvalues and eigenvectors, so the solution would be complex. And that's not what we want, right? We have a real system and we want real solutions. So in order to understand that a little bit better, we decompose eigenvalue and eigenvector into its real part and imaginary part. So lambda 1 equals beta plus I omega. And since lambda 2 is a complex conjugate of lambda 1, we can write it as beta minus I omega. Likewise, for the eigenvector, we assume A1 is R plus IS, and then A2 is R minus IS. With this decomposition, even though our solution is complex, or the individual solutions are complex, we can construct real solutions. And we do that by combining our complex conjugate solutions. Right, so we can create a solution Z by simply taking the sum of the two solutions and then divide by half. And we can construct a second solution by taking the difference and dividing by 2i. This is simply a consequence of complex numbers, right? If you have a pair of complex conjugate numbers, so this would be y1, y2, you can generate from these as a linear combination, and that's important because we know that because of the superposition principle, if you have two solutions, you can use linear combinations as well as solutions. So in a particular linear combination that works here is y1 plus y2 divided by 2, then we end up here. So that's simply the mean of the solutions y1 and y2. If we take the negative of y2, that would be up here, we can take the average of y1 and minus y2, so this would be minus y2, and that would bring us here. And then we have to divide by I in order to get to a real solution, which would then be here. Yeah, so we can generate two real solutions by either taking the sum of y1 and y2 and dividing by 2, or taking the difference and dividing by 2i. Now for our solutions of the differential equation yi, the situation is slightly more complicated because these solutions are not just complex numbers. They are vectorial functions that change in time, so they are trajectories. But the general approach still works, right? So what I've shown here on the right side is sort of an illustration of the principle, but don't take this literally. Now to see how I get to this result, let us do a little side calculation. So here I've simply multiplied a1 with the exponential of lambda 1 t, have used the property that a1 equals r plus is, and lambda 1 equals beta plus I omega. Then I've used the normal relationship that the exponential of a sum is the product of the exponentials. And then I've used the relationship between the exponential and cosine and sine. With that, I arrive at these two larger expressions, which are quite symmetric. The first one is a real part, and the second one is an imaginary part of y1. And since we know that y2 is the complex conjugate of y1, we don't have to redo the calculation. We simply take the complex conjugate, which means we flip the sign of the imaginary part. And now it is easy to figure out z1, which is the sum of y1 and y2, which leaves only the real part because the imaginary part cancels out. And if you divide by 2, we actually get the real part. Otherwise, y1, y2 would be 2 times the real part. So we get, so z1 is just the real part, and z2 just the imaginary part of y1 and y2. And this is what is written here and here. z2 can be transformed in this way, where we have replaced sine by cosine of the argument minus pi over 2, and we have replaced cosine by minus sine of the argument minus pi over 2. So we see that z2 is just a 90 degree shifted version of z1. Now to interpret z1 and z2, please notice that both are linear combinations of r and s, and this linear combination contains a common exponential factor, namely exponential of beta t, and then a rotation that expressed with sine omega t and cosine omega t. So let's consider this in greater detail. So let us put ourselves in the plane spanned by the two vectors r and s. R and s are real vectors, and they live in the space of the solution y. So they live in a two-dimensional, well, they live in a high-dimensional space, but they span a two-dimensional subspace. Now let us start by considering the solution in the coordinate system by r and s. So we use r and s as a basis, so we do a basis transform, and then we are on the right graph. So the original graph is on the left side, and now we put ourselves into a coordinate system that is governed by r and s, so that r and s are the unit vectors of the coordinate system. Let us further simplify and assume for the time being that beta equals zero. That would mean that the exponential of beta t equals 1. So z1 in that case would simply be, yeah, because we can cancel the exponential and r points in the direction of the first component and s points in the direction of the second component. So therefore, cosine omega t is the first component and minus sine of omega t is the second component. Now this simply is a rotation, right? So you start at r and then you rotate clockwise in this case because the sine has a minus sign, the sine function has a minus sign in front of it. So you would have a circle like this. This solution cycles through once if omega t is 2 pi. So it starts here with t equals 0. It ends here at the same location as t is 2 pi divided by omega. And then this happens in the coordinate system of r and s. Now if you go back into the original coordinate system, we would start at r at time t equals 0. We would be at this other end, so at negative s at time t equals pi over 2 omega. Here at t equals pi over 2, pi over omega. Here at times t 2 pi divided by 3 omega, and then here again at time 2 pi over omega. So we would also cycle through, but since r and s don't have equal length, the solution would form an ellipse. If beta is smaller than 0, then the solution would exponentially decay towards 0 because all these terms here have this exponential factor, and if beta is less than 0, it would be a decay. If beta is greater than 0, it would be an exponential growth. We get that in a moment. So the solution would, I mean, it would rotate with the same speed, but it would decay towards the origin. Likewise here. And for beta greater than 0, it would grow. So we see that with complex eigenvalues and eigenvectors, the solution rotates in the plane spanned by r and s. The angular velocity, or rather the time that it takes to make a full revolution, is determined by omega. In the coordinate system on the right side, omega would strictly be the angular velocity, while on the left side, because of the distortion through the vectors r and s, which don't have the same length and are not orthogonal, the trajectory is relatively fast here and slow here. If beta is less than 0, then the solution spirals in. It decays towards 0. If beta is greater than 0, it spirals out. And obviously that would be an unstable fixed point if beta is greater than 0. For negative omega, it would go in the other direction, right? So right now it goes from r to negative s to negative r to positive s to r, and if omega would be negative, would go the other way around. If beta is zero, we have seen that the dynamics describes an ellipse in the RS plane, and this is then called a center. Otherwise, it's a spiral. That's a very intuitive name. And if beta is less than zero, it's asymptotically stable, and for beta greater than zero, it's an unstable fixed point. And figure 2 shows a few examples, like the ones that I've just drawn. In this case, R and S are orthogonal to each other. And in the more general case that I've just described, R and S are not orthogonal to each other. They don't have to be orthogonal to each other. On the left side, beta is less than zero because we see the solution spiraling in. In the middle, beta is zero, and on the right side, it's spiraling out, so beta is greater than zero. The direction of rotation is the same in all three plots. If they are complex, they always come in complex conjugate pairs. And this means the solution rotates in the and the velocity within that plane is determined by the eigenvalue. In particular, if the real part is smaller than one, smaller than if the in particular if the real part is less than is the same, or it does not decay or grow, it stays on the ellipse. And if it is greater than zero, the fixed point is unstable.